And I want to dig a little bit more into that right now. And we do look at, again, the second largest increase we've seen in coronavirus cases since this all began, including marked rises in Florida, showing there COVID-19 cases up 5.3% versus the last 7-day average of just 3.7%. Hospitalizations in that state rising by about 1.9%. That single day largest increase we've seen in a month. Arizona, also another worrying state here, reporting a high of 3,500 new cases yesterday, and worse yet, the ICU capacity there getting stretched already. Again, kind of early in the new spike of cases, 84% of ICU beds were listed as in use in the state of Arizona. And for more on all this, I want to bring on a doctor who's on the ground there. Dr. Mortaza Akter joins us now, clinical assistant professor in emergency medicine at the University of Arizona College of Medicine, Phoenix. And Dr. Akter, I mean, when we look at it, obviously, anytime you see ICU bed capacity spiking is not a good sign when you think about how stretched these hospitals are. But what are you seeing early on in battling this on the ground there?
Hey, thank you for having me. Yeah, I mean, trying to getting close to ICU capacity by the numbers is already bad. On the ground, it's actually even more concerning because remember, these stats that everybody's being given are for basically ICU capacity, in particular for COVID beds. What's ending up happening is while we do have the ability to flex with some of the hospitals in the valley using our surge line for people who need the ICU, because you can imagine there are other people who are also sick and need ICU care. For people who need the ICU but don't have COVID, it gets really tough to find spots for them. And so whether they have COVID or not, the critical patients are backing up into the emergency department. And as you can imagine, that adds a lot of stress to a situation that's already semi-chaotic. So far, we've been handling it, but it's only going to get worse. And that's what's really concerning.
Yeah, when you say things might get worse there, I think that's one of the things that a lot of people are surprisingly kind of disagreeing on here when we think about whether it's just more testing being implemented here. That's not necessarily what the data is showing. When you look at the positivity rate across the U.S. here, also going up, Florida's new positivity rate jumping to 15.9% from just 10% a day ago. And with the country trending in the same direction, are you seeing something similar in Arizona? And if it's not just testing going up, what do you think is contributing to that increase in the positivity rate?
Yeah, that alternate impression is completely wrong. And Zach, I think your viewers are smarter than the average person and won't be fooled by fuzzy numbers. If you increase testing, yes, you'll get more positive cases, but you'll also get more negative cases, in particular when you're testing more widespread in the community, including patients who are presumably less symptomatic and therefore presumably less likely to have COVID. So if anything, the percent of people who are positive should drop. In our case, in Arizona, it hasn't dropped, it's gone up. And not only has it gone up, it's surged up. We're at 21, 22%, even higher than Florida. That is a ridiculously high number of cases. And you can't just say it's from testing because the percent rate, the ratio has actually gone up dramatically. And the other reason that's concerning is because remember, even if they're getting positive now and surging now for positive cases, they might not decompensate for a couple of weeks. When I'm in the ER, the sickest patients I see are the ones who already knew they had COVID. They'd had COVID for 5 days, for 10 days. And then they come back to the ER because they're struggling to breathe or their oxygen levels are low. So the real crush, my fear is that the real crush is going to happen a few weeks from now. And that's really, really concerning.
Yeah, and that's kind of what a lot of people are scared of, right? When we think about flattening the curve being the initial push. And we just showed that chart. I just stress that like the numbers there and the positivity rate that we saw going up and down back in March, again, due to kind of complications with testing and really rolling out testing, a lot's been made to get more tests out. That at least is true. But when we look at maybe what could be happening there, as you said, the delay between the spiking cases we're talking about here with the U.S., the second largest increase we've seen, and the lag time between hospitalizations, how stressed in terms of, we already said how stressed you're going to be, but when it comes to treatment options now, what has changed maybe from what we saw back in March to maybe help in actual individual patients battling to survive this?
So what I say here has to be interpreted very carefully because sometimes people bite on something that is said and make it seem like it's a miracle drug. The most recent data we have for dexamethasone shows that it does seem to work in reducing mortality in those patients who are intubated or needing respiratory support, for example, BiPAP. It does reduce mortality. The key word is reduce, not make it go away. So for some reason, people think, oh my goodness, what a great drug. And you know, the preliminary data, we have to have peer reviewed and everything, but the preliminary data do look good. The problem is what looks good in medicine doesn't necessarily mean it's a miracle drug. there are lots of things that we do that only reduce mortality by 10%. If you reduce mortality by 10%, you've got a wonder drug, okay? But obviously the other 90% aren't affected. So the real concern here is that even if we have a treatment, it's only for specifically ICU patients who need respiratory support. And it basically reduces symptoms, doesn't make them go away. There's still going to be lots of people who die. There is no wonder drug. There never will be a wonder drug, honestly. Even if we have a vaccine, it won't be 100%. People really need to be careful about distancing themselves.
Which, again, I think would be important to kind of stress what we have been stressing here on the show, which is proactive and preventative measures here to really try and reduce the initial amount of cases to prevent anyone going to the ICU or, worse yet, deaths there on the back end. But when you think about that, we've seen masks being used in some states versus others. Here in New York, we are now hearing about the plans here to order governors here in the tri-state area ordering new travelers coming back to the tri-state area from states such as yours in Arizona and other problem areas where we're seeing cases rise, quarantining the order there for 14 days. What's your take on maybe how things have shifted so much in the policies that were used here in the tri-state area to see things kind of recover, bring down the curve, versus what we're seeing now play out in Arizona and other states as well?
That's a great question, and some of that goes even beyond medicine a little bit. I'm not a constitutional scholar or anything, but this is what happens when you try to use federalism at the science level. A couple months ago, maybe a month ago, the president passed the buck to the governors. In our state, the governor passed the buck regarding masks to the mayors. Now, as you can imagine, the mayors can say, you know what, we'll let neighborhoods decide for themselves. But the thing is, coronavirus, unlike maybe laws, coronavirus doesn't know state borders or city borders or even national borders, right? It transcends all borders and affects all sorts of people. And so if you have some people wearing a mask and their neighbors in another town not wearing a mask, unless those people are hermits and stay in their homes, which is clearly not the case, and New York is clearly smart enough to know this, as soon as those people cross with each other, that virus gets transmitted. And so the problem with having some people wearing masks and not others is that that spread is still going to be there. Even with masks, there will be spread. And so the fact that people are saying, you know, this is America, do what you want, that's fine from a legal, constitutional, whatever perspective. But from a public health and science perspective, that's a terrible idea. We just have a very different culture here. There's no other country in the world that I know of that debates masks. It's like ridiculous. This is the only country I know of that debates masks. You know, people don't even debate seatbelts anymore. I guess they used to. To debate masks during a pandemic is so utterly ironic that it's hard to comprehend.
Yeah, and we're unfortunately seeing the data now play out there as Europe, who instituted a lot of these changes, was able to bring their case count down. Ours, unfortunately, now turning in the opposite direction. But Dr. Mortaza Akhtar, appreciate you taking the time to chat with us, and good luck with everything out there in Arizona.
I appreciate it. Thank you. Stay safe. Best of luck to you guys as well.
If you're interested in learning more about the markets and getting the latest financial news, well, then click right here to subscribe to our Yahoo Finance YouTube channel. Get the latest up-to-the-minute market analysis, big interviews in the world of finance, and information on how to manage your money every day, wherever you are.